Audible Inc. presents Thou Shall Prosper, 10 Commandments for Making Money. Written by Rabbi Daniel Lapin. Narrated by A.C. Fellner.
Introduction. Mark Twain once wrote, "The Jews constitute but 1% of the human race. Properly, the Jew ought hardly to be heard of. But he is heard of, has always been heard of. He is a successful businessman. The immense wholesale business of Broadway is substantially in his hands. 85% of the great and lucrative businesses of Germany are in the hands of the Jewish race. The Jew is a money getter. In reality, Jews do not constitute even 0.1% of the human race." Mark Twain may have grossly overestimated the size of the world's Jewish population, but he was quite right to observe that Jews are disproportionately successful in business. From notorious Nazis to Hasidic scholars, from Japan's cultural commentators to conspiracy theorists who have never met a Jew, all who have examined the historic and current identity of the Jewish people acknowledge one simple truth: Jews are good at business. This is true not only in the United States of the 21st century, but also in many countries over many centuries. Whether in Europe, North Africa, or the United States, Jews have always been both reviled and admired. Jews are hated and envied. They are despised and loved. For people that make up only a little over 2% of the U.S. population, they are disproportionately influential in so many areas of American life. They are spoken of, written about, and depicted far more than other groups of similar size. Part of the reason for this is surely their conspicuous economic success. I hope that this observation does not make you squeamish. I am not trying to affirm anti-Semitic stereotypes of the money-grabbing Jew. On the contrary, I am dispelling the anti-Semitic canard. Remember that Judaism itself has never seen wealth as evidence of misdeed. In fact, this book will show that although there are obvious exceptions found in all faiths, for the most part, people prosper when they live among many others, all behaving decently and honorably toward one another. As an Orthodox rabbi, I have devoted much of my research to studying and isolating those characteristics that have helped Jews excel in business. This book makes these characteristics available in usable form for all readers, regardless of faith. You might be wondering, if he knows the secrets of wealth creation, why doesn't he just get on with creating wealth instead of writing the secrets down for others? The answer, as you shall see in the pages ahead, is that your prosperity does not mean that there is any less for me. My lengthy investigation into the accumulated wisdom of 3,000 years of Jewish scholarship reveals precisely the reverse. The more wealth that the people around me create, the more I shall benefit too. You do want more money, don't you? Don't be embarrassed to admit that you want more money. Think of all the good things you could do if you had more discretionary income and more accumulated assets. I'm not suggesting that you corrode your soul with a deep sense of discontent. You can be very happy with your life and grateful for its many blessings while simultaneously desiring more. That doesn't make you an ungrateful, whiny person. So, would you like more money? Just say, "Yes, I would like more money than I now have." Not only do I think you want more money, I sincerely hope you want more money. The more money you want, the more you will be willing to work and produce for me and for countless other people. It makes me happy to know that there are many humans just like you out there, all eager to have more money and therefore all eager to do things for me. One of the ancient Jewish sages, Ben Zoma, once found himself in a crowd of people. Some around him were probably complaining about being jostled by the masses. Ben Zoma laughed joyously and said, "Blessed is the Creator who has created all these people to serve me." Continuing, he mused aloud, "Think what Adam had to endure before he could eat bread. He plowed, he planted, he reaped, he bound the sheaves, he threshed and winnowed, he ground the ears, and he sifted the flour. He then kneaded and baked, and then at last he ate. Whereas I get up each morning and find all these things done for me." How much did Adam have to do to obtain clothing? He had to shear sheep, wash the wool, comb it, spin it, and weave it. I get up each morning and find all these things done for me. All kinds of craftsmen come to the very door of my house and supply me with whatever I need. Like Ben Zoma, I see other people as vital contributors to my well-being. However, all this is true only if you want more money. If you are living on a park bench, panhandling passers-by, and feeling quite content with your life, you are unlikely to be motivated to do anything for me. If you feel that struggling through the month trying to figure out which bills to pay is just the way things are, you are unlikely to expend any energies trying to figure out how to supply some of the things that everyone else would like to have. If you feel you have made more than enough money, and that now you should devote your years to improving your golf handicap, well, you aren't much good to me either. Although many different kinds of people in diverse situations are helpful in one way or another to their fellow humans, there is one group of people that is truly useful to everyone else. Those people eager to earn more money. If you are in that group, then this book is for you. The recipe. You don't have to aspire to drive the Indianapolis 500 to learn valuable life lessons from the great racing driver Mario Andretti. He could probably teach you much about handling stress in everyday life and extracting peak performance from yourself. Likewise, you don't have to be Jewish to have access to the lessons of wealth that have been part of traditional Jewish culture for centuries. Take a look at the magazine racks next time you have a few minutes to visit a large bookstore. You will notice at least two or three monthly magazines catering to each and every interest, no matter how narrow or esoteric. Interested in learning more about model railroading? Start picking up those two or three journals each month and read them. Then visit your library and explore its section on trains. Sooner or later, you will find yourself immersed in a new world with its own language, its own skills, its own merchants, and its own universe of enthusiasts. Soon your friends will notice that you have absorbed a new culture. New things interest you. You now choose to spend your time and money on model train layouts instead of on whatever used to excite you. Similarly, should you desire to find out more about bodybuilding, bicycling, or owning BMW motor cars, there's a world of wisdom out there, and an entire culture awaiting you. Making money is not so different from other interests. It, too, involves skills and requires immersion in a new culture. The one difference between making money on the one hand and bicycling or collecting model trains on the other hand is that the latter are some of the things you might choose to do with some of your time. You might take slices out of your life to indulge your hobby. You might devote an hour each day to working out at a gym. Although these activities enrich your life, they occupy separate little cubbyholes in your existence. They don't much shape how you live the rest of your life. If you play in a bowling league each Tuesday evening, or race your sailboat on Saturdays, well, these activities also play little role in the rest of your life. However, learning how to increase your ability to make money and produce wealth suffuses every aspect of your existence. It sometimes turns things on their heads. For instance, whenever I ask university students why they are studying, their answers invariably revolve around increasing their ability to earn money. Is gaining wisdom all about increasing wealth? No, of course not. The reverse is far truer. Gaining wealth is about increasing wisdom. You could be a hermit with no visible social life at all, yet build and operate a remarkable model train layout. Very rarely does a person accumulate wealth without acquiring social skills. Does this mean that you should learn to get along with people in order to make money? No, of course not. But learning how to make money does inevitably improve your relationship with others. This book makes the Jewish approach to money and wealth accessible and useful to anyone. It will describe some of the secrets of Jewish business success and will show how they can be adopted by all people regardless of faith or background. You will explore this culture that has produced such disproportionate wealth, and you will find the tips, tools, and techniques that you will apply to your life. And the best part of it is that by doing so, you will be helping those around you just as much as you help yourself. Before identifying the powerful wealth-producing concepts that lie at the root of success, I need to dispel some incorrect notions. 4 false theories about Jewish business success. There are 4 popular but false theories that are frequently advanced to account for Jewish business success. I will debunk each in turn and then explore the truth. As with most falsehoods that endure, tiny kernels of truth are found in some of them. The falsehoods gain credibility and currency from the tiny truths they contain, but they obscure our investigation until put to rest. These 4 popular theories are: 1. Spurred by anti-Semitic persecution, Jews evolved by natural selection into a race of money-making geniuses. 2. Jews cheat. The 1971 edition of the Oxford English Dictionary, sitting on my bookshelf, defines the word Jew as a verb meaning to cheat or overreach in the way attributed to Jewish traders. 3. Jews secretly network and devotedly advance one another's interests. 4. The high average intelligence of Jews accounts for their fiscal talent. Each of these 4 mistaken explanations can be refuted. False theory number 1. Jews learned how to make money because of natural selection. This first explanation suggests that wherever Jews were persecuted, poor Jews, unable to bribe their way to freedom, were caught and killed by tormentors, whereas rich Jews procured their escape and survived, free to breed. In order to take this explanation seriously, it would be necessary to believe in a sort of money gene buried in the DNA of Jews, much in the way that the Darwinian theory of natural selection is believed to work. The money gene theory would mean that those with the gene were able to breed and retain the money gene in the Jewish gene pool. The only problem with this manifestly racist explanation is that no such gene exists. False theory number 2. Jews cheat to get ahead. The second fallacious theory suggests that Jews seize an advantage in business by cheating. or by using excessively aggressive business practices. Although the occasional Jew may be dishonest, something that is true for every ethnic, religious, and racial group in the world, duplicity and obnoxiousness are hardly broad-based Jewish characteristics. And although it is true that in earlier times people disparagingly used the expression, "He Jewed me down," frequently without ever having met a Jew, nonetheless, I don't think that language usage reliably points to a Jewish cultural trait. The Jewish guidebook, known in its totality as the Torah, a comprehensive blueprint of reality whose foundation is the Bible, contains over 5 times as many laws dealing with honesty in business as it has laws concerning the kosher dietary rules. Furthermore, to accept the theory that Jews prosper primarily by cheating, we would have to accept that cheating, or being obnoxious, confers an advantage in business. But dishonesty and loathsome behavior only pay off in the very short term. Reputation is key. Sooner or later, the cheating, dishonest, and unpleasant business professional runs out of people with whom to conduct business. In contrast, the story told to me by Southern California investor and healthcare entrepreneur David Holder is typical. David became his family's breadwinner at the age of 13 when his mother was abandoned in the small town of Moorhead, Mississippi. Its population then was 1,500. You get to know folks pretty well in small towns. Struggling to support her family, Mrs. Holder worked as a waitress in the local cafe. David remembers being 13 years old when his mother sent him out to seek work. "You must find work with one of the 4 Jewish families in town," she insisted. "Start off by asking Harry Diamond to give you a chance." Harry Diamond, member of the Moorhead City Council, ran the haberdashery store, Diamond's Department Store, that his late father, old Mr. Diamond, had started decades earlier. Harry hired the young boy and became his mentor, friend, and boss. David worked for him until he was 18. And to this day, David credits Harry Diamond's lessons and generosity with much of the enormous success that he has since enjoyed in business. As I have traveled the country on business, many people have shared similar fond memories of warm friendships and honorable partnerships with Jews. Given the large number of long-term partnerships and business relationships that people of all backgrounds have enjoyed with Jews over the years, I have to dismiss this second theory. False theory number 3. All Jews belong to a secret network. The third false theory hangs on the quaint notion that all Jews really do love one another and constantly seek opportunities to help one another. This absurdity is about as true for all Jews as it is for all Christians, all tennis players, or all bald-headed men. It is certainly true that any large and united group of people who devotedly advance one another's interests would prosper. As a rabbi, I would have to admit sadly that as desirable as such fraternal feelings would be, it is simply not the case in the American Jewish community. Jews argue about everything. Somehow the more involved in Judaism and the Jewish community the Jews are, the more frenetic and intense their arguments seem to become. As the following joke illustrates, Jewish argumentativeness is so well known that it is central to the culture. A young scholar was invited to become the new rabbi of a little old synagogue. During his very first Sabbath service, a hot debate erupted as to whether people should stand or sit during the reading of the Ten Commandments. Next day, the rabbi visited 98-year-old Mr. Katz in a local nursing home. "Mr. Katz, I'm asking you as the oldest member of the community," said the rabbi, "what is our synagogue's custom during the reading of the Ten Commandments?" "Why do you ask?" asked Mr. Katz. "Yesterday, we read the Ten Commandments. Some people stood, some people sat. The one standing started screaming at the one sitting, telling them to stand up. The one sitting started screaming at the one standing, telling them to sit down. "That," said the old man, "is our custom." Here's another story about two Jews. Unfortunately, this one is not a joke. It is just as typical of what happens to Jewish partnerships that sour as it is of what happens to such partnerships between people of any faiths. Jeffrey Katzenberg, former studio chief at Disney, left his old friend Michael Eisner, chief executive officer, CEO, in 1994 after Disney chairman Eisner denied him a sought-after promotion. The hostility escalated for about 5 years until it exploded into a court case. Katzenberg filed a civil lawsuit against Disney and sat quietly as the man who was once considered his closest friend, Michael Eisner, was forced to admit that he had probably said of Mr. Katzenberg, "I hate the little midget." Like everyone else, Jews do business with people they like and trust, regardless of religious and ethnic background. False theory number four: Jews are smarter than everyone else. The fourth false theory for Jewish business success is that, as a group, Jews possess unusually high intelligence. Whether that is true is unimportant. What is important is that it just doesn't matter. Outside of a broad range of acceptability, IQ is almost irrelevant to business success. Being super smart is as detrimental to success in business as is being just plain dumb. The story of Forrest Gump becoming a business mogul is just that, a movie story. It would not happen in real life. Someone whose IQ is simply too low for him or her to function may be a loving person and a fine worker, but not someone who is going to succeed as an entrepreneur in business or anywhere else. That is a sad fact of life. An IQ that slides way down the left-hand slope of the IQ bell curve toward the low numbers condemns you to fail in business. That should not surprise you. However, here's the shocker. After decades in the rabbinate and around business, during which time I carefully and closely observed hundreds of people in dozens of occupations, it became quite clear to me that an IQ that slides down the right-hand slope of the IQ bell curve into the upper triple digits just as likely condemns you to fail in business. But wait. Isn't Bill Gates of Microsoft reputed to possess an unusually high IQ? Certainly he does. But remember, this book is not about becoming Bill Gates. Bill Gates is a rare aberration. He is an event that occurs only once or twice in an epoch when absolutely everything lines up perfectly. To be Bill Gates requires a very high IQ. However, to be astoundingly successful in business, say, as successful as Sam Walton of Walmart, one need only possess an IQ that falls within a very broad range of acceptability. If indeed Jews as a group do enjoy exceptionally high intelligence, they succeed in business in spite of those scores, not because of them. Super brilliant intellectuals become idiosyncratic chess players, or they tend to gravitate to the faculties of major universities. For the most part, they are notoriously inept at business and seldom become tycoons. They are often seen as brilliant, but not quite with it. To succeed in business, it is far more important to know how the world really works than it is to be brilliant. For every Thomas Edison who both was brilliant and became affluent through his brilliance, there are many stories of creative inventors who died penniless and whose invention was later utilized and marketed by a much more normal person who made his or her own fortune. The good news is that although it is very difficult to increase one's native intelligence, it is considerably easier to learn how the world works. The true explanation for Jewish success in business and money matters. If these four theories are false, what then does account for the fact that in country after country, century after century, Jews have consistently been at the top of the economic scale, despite battling prejudice and roadblocks every step of the way? Before I answer that, I should tell you a little more of what you can gain from this book. Although Americans believe in each person's ability to carve out his or her own life, it is childlike not to acknowledge that each person is born with certain gifts and blessings. People like to think that everyone is born equal. However, some win the geographic lottery by being born in a free and prosperous country, while others lose. Some win the genetic lottery in looks or athletic skills, while others do not stand out in these areas. No matter how wonderful a human being I might be, I am never going to be chosen to succeed Queen Elizabeth as England's next monarch. No matter how much I love music, and no matter how hard I practice on my piano, I am unlikely to succeed in becoming the conductor of the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra. My son may endure sports, but with genetically determined height limitations, he is not going to be able to go one-on-one with Michael Jordan. These limitations condemn nobody to a life without power, music, or athletics. But each person begins life with a head start in some area and a handicap in other areas. I had the great blessing and advantage of being born into a family that took God's word, the Torah, most seriously. Also, for generations, my family has devoted itself to probing and understanding thousands of years of Jewish scholarship that has emanated from the oral tradition of the written Torah. Most everything of value that I have learned about money and economic success is derived not just from my very limited personal experience, but chiefly from history's most enduring, longitudinal study of the psychology and sociology of a financially successful people. The principal foundations of this 3,000-year-long study are captured in Talmudic and Kabbalistic sources that can be fully comprehended only in their original Aramaic and Hebrew. They form the bedrock of my own belief system. It is the prism that resolves reality for me into its principal colors. It has deeply influenced my values and professional opinions, and I never try to conceal that. The Torah has much to say about financial interactions. Although originally delivered to the Jewish people, many of the principles are universal and are as true for any one individual as they are for any other, regardless of religious affiliation or lack thereof. These ideas constitute the core of this book and can be useful to you regardless of your background. I have no ability to make you wealthy enough to find your way onto the Forbes magazine list of the 400 wealthiest Americans. I cannot rule it out either, but I would be foolish to guarantee you that stratospheric level of financial success. The techniques of this book will put you on to the road to maximizing what you can accomplish. You take it from there on your own. I don't believe that you can train to become Bill Gates or Warren Buffett. These are unique individuals for whom many factors of talent and timing came together in an almost magical way. Similarly, I don't believe that anyone can promise a budding artist that he or she will be the next Michelangelo, or guarantee that following a certain set of rules will make you President of the United States. But there are very specific steps one can take that will help one become a better artist or a more successful politician than one might otherwise have been. In the same way, there are certain steps one can take that will lead one to greater financial achievement. Considering the disproportionate number of Jews on the Forbes 400 list each year, it seems that Jews do possess knowledge of the steps to take in creating wealth. Jews constitute about 2.3% of the U.S. population. That means that there should be about 9 Jews on the Forbes 400 list. In reality, depending on the year, there are between 60 and 100 Jews on this prestigious list. Similar data for the more average population reveal that the percentage of Jewish households with income greater than $50,000 is double that of non-Jews. I shall identify those steps that have made this success possible and present them for you. Following those steps may not bring you to the attention of Forbes magazine, but doing so will help you make far more money than you would otherwise. Knowing how the world really works. Certain fundamental principles detailing how the world works have been deeply ingrained in the Jewish people since the time of Abraham. Over the generations, even as many Jews have abandoned their spiritual source and forsaken their religious practices, these illustrative principles have lingered and remained powerful shapers of a people. Let me give you an example. The Jewish people are known worldwide as the people of the book. This originally referred to the Bible. But a side benefit of the fact that Judaism always expected every Jew to be literate in order to read the book was that Jews have always had a disproportionately high literacy rate and a respect for education. Howard Schultz, the CEO and chairman of the Starbucks coffee empire, describes how his parents scrimped and saved in order to send him to college. He wrote, "After 4 years, I became the first college graduate in my family. To my parents, I had attained the big prize, a diploma. But I had no direction. No one ever helped me see the value in the knowledge I was gaining. I've often joked since then, if someone had provided me with direction and guidance, I really could have been somebody." Well, guess what, Howard? Someone did provide you with direction and guidance. It was those people who scrimped and saved in order to send you to college. Your parents. They did implant in you traditional Jewish direction and guidance. They injected you with two ideas. One, the conviction that one sacrifices present pleasures for future benefits. And two, a respect for the value of education. And they were pretty darn successful. You know how I know? It's easy. As a business consultant, I have studied your leadership of Starbucks. I know how many times you have sacrificed your present pleasures for the long-term good of your company. And I also know how much emphasis you place on how much money you dedicate to education.
Yes, I'd say your Jewish parents deserve much credit for your success.
Bookshelves and books are such an identifiable feature of a Jewish home that an acquaintance of mine tells the story of how one day she rebelled against the piles of books all over her family's living room. In a frenzy of orderliness, she banished all the books to other areas of the house, desiring to have at least one neat room. A young man who had been courting her daughter visited their home for the first time. He was welcomed and invited to enjoy a cup of tea in this newly tidied room. Later, after the subsequent marriage, the young man informed his chagrined mother-in-law that on seeing no books, he almost turned around and walked back out the door that first night. His immediate conclusion had been that he couldn't possibly have anything in common with such a strange, bookless family. Just as cherishing books has remained a characteristic of Jewish homes, even of those homes not strongly identified as religious or even Jewish, There are many other characteristics that remain deeply embedded in the Jewish psyche. These are characteristics that everyone seeking success should emulate until they become second nature. Jewish tradition teaches that after you have done new things consistently for a while, you can feel yourself to have become a different person. One example that probably everyone has experienced is contrasting how you feel at the beginning of an exercise regimen with how you feel once you have been at it for a few months. What was an almost unendurable daily burden gradually stopped being painful and finally became an essential part of having a good day. The strenuous daily program started to give you a high of good feeling. You didn't just start feeling differently about an exercise workout. Your very muscles, tendons, and tissues, your heart and your lungs changed. One way of looking at it, and a fairly accurate way at that, is that you became a different person. You probably already realize that acquiring more money will require that you learn not only new facts, but also new intuitions and new ways of responding to situations. Seeing oneself as having become an entirely new and different person is essential to any major growth step. It is an accurate perception. If you really grew, then you really changed. It is as simple as that. It is no accident that many fervent religious believers describe their spiritual advances in terms of being born again. Becoming a different person is not nearly as formidable as it sounds. Before I show you how to do it, let me show you why doing so is necessary. Success requires learning and practice. Suppose you were interested in becoming proficient in self-defense. You might start by reading several excellent books on martial arts. Will you now be ready to fearlessly tread the mean streets after dark? Of course not. Imagine this scenario. As a malevolent arm snakes around your neck from the rear and a hard and cold object prods you in the ribs, you bravely reach into your hip pocket to locate your well-worn copy of Everyone's Guide to Self-Defense. You try to flip through the pages as you gasp for breath. Chapter 7, you recall, describes suitable responses to attacks from behind. Unfortunately, by that time, the sad outcome of the unpleasant encounter will be difficult to change. It would not even have helped much had you memorized the contents of the book. The only way to improve your confidence on the streets in a meaningful way is to attend classes regularly and practice the moves until they become second nature to you. That way, when attacked, your body will automatically respond in mere milliseconds. You will react instantly, powerfully, and effectively because you bypass the slow logic centers of your brain. To the utter dismay of your assailant, you will have become a new person, quite different from the fearful old victim he mugged last year. The parallel to business will become clear when you recall some negotiation or other in which you thought of dozens of brilliant and inspired thrusts and counter-thrusts. The only problem was that you thought of these illuminating points during the ride back from the meeting, well after its conclusion. During the very transaction itself, you were so busy trying to keep up your side of the negotiation that you had no chance to let your genius shine forth. You obviously would have done better had you just been a different, more experienced negotiator. How does one become a better negotiator? In much the same three-phase method that one becomes better at judo, better at omelet cooking, and better at writing poetry. 1. Learn. 2. Understand. 3. Practice. Phase 1 is learning the techniques. Phase 2 is understanding those principles that lie behind the techniques. Understanding how those techniques work provides assurance that they will work. gaining confidence in the ultimate effectiveness of those techniques is important, because it helps to provide the motivation to keep going with Phase 3. Phase 3 is doggedly and determinedly practicing not only to become proficient in the technique, but also to become a different person. When I emphasize the need for practice, I do so in the same spirit as the piano teacher urging her student to practice. It is how the material becomes part of you. This could be why I sometimes refer to myself as a practicing Jew. The implication is not that with enough practice I might one day get it right, although that may well be true, but that by consistently practicing the religiously mandated behaviors, by doing different things, I will integrate the desired habits into myself, eventually becoming a new person. You should feel comfortable with the idea of constantly practicing the techniques that will be discussed here and making them a regular component of your daily life. What made me write this book? In 1978, I had the privilege of participating in the founding of a congregation in Los Angeles, which I then served for 15 years. For the most part, most rabbis who accept positions in existing congregations must adjust themselves to existing patterns and customs for fear of antagonizing longtime members. As the founding rabbi of Pacific Jewish Center, I was fortunate in that I was able to set the customs and the patterns that would shape the synagogue's future. Hoping to emulate the patterns from ancient Jewish tradition in which the community's leaders and teachers were themselves also engaged in earning their own livings, I too declined to accept a salary from the congregation. I look back on those years and sometimes think I may have been wrong about this. But I decided that instead of being a paid rabbi, I would take a job in business. I worked for several companies, including Merrill Lynch, supporting my family while gaining business experience, and later opened my own real estate finance company. I well recalled the story my father would relate so frequently about the famous 18th century preacher, Rabbi Jacob Kranz of Dubno, Lithuania. Shortly before the High Holy Days one year, Rabbi Kranz found himself visiting his friend and colleague, the equally famous Rabbi Elijah of Vilna, later known as the Genius of Vilna. The latter invited his trusted guest, Rabbi Kranz, to help him probe his own moral shortcomings in anticipation of the forthcoming Day of Atonement. Rabbi Kranz thought for a moment and asked, "Are you really sure you want me to offer you criticism?" Rabbi Elijah answered that in his hometown of Vilna, he was held in such high esteem that nobody would dare help him confront the areas in which he could personally improve. Somewhat reassured but still apprehensive, Rabbi Kranz obeyed the request and criticized his venerable host. As the respected and well-compensated leader of the entire Vilna Jewish community, you enjoy the benefits of being able to spend your days in rabbinic research, prayer, and answering questions. You seldom even have to leave your home other than to attend services in the nearby synagogue. Obviously, everyone thinks you are a saint. Why shouldn't you be? What real challenges do you ever have to confront? You have absolutely no idea at all of what life is like for ordinary people who have to struggle in the marketplace each day in pursuit of a livelihood. In the midst of 100 daily opportunities for dishonesty and discourtesy, they still conduct their affairs honorably. During the coming 10 days of penitence, you cannot even begin to compare yourself with those members of your synagogue who are earning a living in business, raising their families, and are engaged in communal welfare. As he reached the punchline to the often-told tale, a profoundly sad expression would always steal across my father's features. looking much the way I imagined that Rabbi Elijah of Vilna looked on hearing those penetrating words of disparagement 2 centuries ago, my father would end the story thus: "And the genius of Vilna broke down and wept inconsolably." As his eldest son, I always sensed that my father, having spent his entire life in the rabbinate, felt that he too deserved the same censure. Certainly, on some subconscious level, this part of my background played a role in influencing my decision to devote myself to 2 simultaneous careers, congregational rabbi and Los Angeles business professional. In this way, my wife, Susan, and I enjoyed the enormous benefits of being our congregants' friends rather than their employees. This rabbinic status, common in Talmudic times but rare today, also granted me some other valuable benefits. I was able to regulate admission to my Torah study lectures, of which I delivered about 7 each week. Because I was not a congregational employee, I chose to welcome only those who stimulated me and those whose presence contributed to the intellectual excitement of the sessions. Not surprisingly, most of the 60 or 70 attendees at each session were considerably more accomplished than I was. Some were directors of investment banking houses like Bear Stearns and Drexel Burnham. Others were scientists at local aerospace concerns like TRW and Hughes. And some were well known in Hollywood's entertainment industry. I quickly discovered the truth of the Talmudic dictum of Rabbi Hanina, who said, "I have learned much from my teachers, even more from my colleagues, but I have learned most, by far, from my students." I carried the principle of rabbinic financial independence still further, maybe too much further. I declined to participate in what I felt was the somewhat clumsy arrangement whereby the clergy are usually proffered a check after officiating at a wedding or a funeral. I had noticed the discomfort experienced by my rabbinic colleagues at these life cycle events when a proud bridegroom or a mourning relative would press an envelope into the rabbi's hands. The rabbi would furtively slip the envelope into a breast pocket to be glanced at later. To me, it seemed almost like a tip. My feeling was that the amount was seldom enough to compensate me at what I considered to be my hourly value, but just enough to deprive me of the feeling of being a giver. When the well-intentioned tried to press the envelope into my reluctant fingers, I would awkwardly decline, wishing that the circumstances would allow a full explanation for what might have sometimes appeared to be my churlishness. Later, it became clear to me that clergy in general, along with so many other people, feel uncomfortable with money. They feel demeaned by it instead of feeling proud of supplying another person's needs. Jews often recite a well-known blessing after enjoying the food purchased with the work of their hands. The ancient words express gratitude to God for creating human beings with deficiencies and needs. That blessing reminds Jews that helping other people make up for those deficiencies by supplying their needs is how one makes an honorable living. When you receive payment after supplying the needs of a client, a customer, your boss, or if you are a member of the clergy, even a congregant, that money is testament to your having pleased another human being. I realized that in spite of having possessed some theoretical knowledge of money, business, finance, and economics, I had utterly failed to internalize it and make it part of my worldview. In discussions with business professionals around the country, it became clear to me that I was not alone. Like them, my business performance was far below where it might have been had I only absorbed and applied all the spiritual rules of financial success. The business failures I suffered were all directly related to ignoring the principles of this book, I knew the commandments and rules in theory. I also knew that the exercise of writing this book would help me absorb these principles and make them part of my day-to-day living. I know that reading it will help you do the same. The Torah, which is the basis of my knowledge of this subject, comprises 613 separate principles. These are categorized into 10 broad headings that we refer to as the Ten Commandments. I have arranged the material that you need to be prosperous into a similar format of 10 broad headings, each of which encompasses many separate principles. The First Commandment: Believe in the dignity and morality of business. Making money is much harder to do if, deep down, you suspect it to be a morally reprehensible activity. If there is one Jewish attribute more directly responsible for Jewish success in business than any other, it is this one. Jewish tradition views a person's quest for profit and wealth to be inherently moral. How could it be otherwise? As I explained in the introduction, who I am and how I earn my living are inextricably bound together. If your chosen means of contributing to the world and, incidentally, providing for your needs and desires is immoral, then you must stop doing it because it will inevitably taint your entire existence. If your life is bifurcated into the work arena and the social arena, with the two never meeting, not even in your own mind, then that is one of the first repair jobs you should undertake. Step one in the process of increasing your income is to begin wrapping yourself around these two related notions. One, you are in business. And two, the occupation of business is moral, noble, and worthy. As you will see, that view of business is not universally shared. Generally speaking, media, entertainment, and public education in the United States all subtly denigrate business. They tend to suggest that government and nonprofit organizations do more for poor people than the private sector does, and that business professionals need to be restrained from committing crimes in their single-minded pursuit of profit. It is not surprising that many other large groups in the United States have come to believe the same. This campaign has been so pervasive that everyone has inevitably been conditioned to believe it, at least to some extent. Believing that making money is a selfish activity will undermine anyone's chances of success. Feel virtuous, grow wealthy. Most people understand that they enjoy greater success when they feel good about their activities. For example, in martial conflict, the defender's advantage is acknowledged by most military experts to be as much as 5-1. This means that the defender's conviction of being right is enough to require a 5-1 superiority on the part of the invader in order for the attack to stand a good chance of success. That is because people tend to feel morally justified in defending their homes and families, whereas an attacker often doubts the righteousness of the cause. It follows that you would have vast additional power to inject into your enterprise if you could simply develop a deep conviction of its intrinsic morality. This is how people are created. For better or worse, humans are holistic. Even the human body does best when its spiritual and physical sides are synchronized. Consider the role of placebos in modern medicine. Against their rational instincts, physicians are forced to recognize that placebos have some effect. Drugs are a vital element of medicine. The patient's mind is the second vital element. Considering placebos to be effective may seem primitive, Primitive beliefs that have been categorically refuted, such as the flat earth theory, are seldom controversial. The very fact that placebos are controversial tells me that a sizable number of credible physicians are persuaded of their efficaciousness. That is what makes the issue controversial. If all doctors agreed that placebos were worthless, the debate would be over. Why would a placebo have any therapeutic impact at all? People's bodies perform better when their brains and souls are on board with the program. This is why most people choose doctors in whom they have confidence. A patient's recovery is directly linked to how much confidence that patient has in his or her medical advisors. It is almost as if your body knows what is in your mind and responds accordingly. Helping your mind to know and believe that what you do professionally is good, noble, and worthwhile in itself helps to fuel your energies and propel your efforts. If you feel really good about your profession, you sweep others along with you on the waves of your enthusiasm for what you do. You will become known for telling entertaining accounts of amusing incidents in your professional life. Stories about events in your business day can inspire others, and they will be moved by poignant interactions you relate. These natural and positive aspects of your public persona flow inevitably from feeling pride and passion for your work. You see, increasing your ability to create wealth is not just a matter of knowing a technology. It is not just a matter of knowing what kind of investments to seek, or knowing how to write a resume. Having additional money in your pocket, real spendable money, is not the same as having a pen or a cigar lighter in your pocket. A substantial and meaningful increase in the amount of money you own changes you. You become a slightly different person, and people notice the change. Now, if extra money makes a new person of you, it easily follows that making a new person of you is a step on the road to having more money. This is what it might look like, expressed as a mathematical equation. Old you plus more money equals new you. Now, subtracting old you from both sides of the equation, remember that whatever you do to one side of the equal sign, you must also do to the other, we have more money equals new you minus old you. In other words, in order to acquire more money, you need to work on far more than merely learning new skills. You have to work on changing yourself. It may not be easy, but it can certainly be done, and it works. As a rabbi, I have always seen the Torah as a comprehensive guide to how the world really works. For instance, I expect no conflict between Torah wisdom and chemistry, and I find none. Both, after all, are instruments that explain how the world works, each from its own perspective. Thus, chemistry might remind me that just as two atoms of hydrogen combined with one atom of oxygen results in one molecule of water, so can a molecule of water be split into its constituents, hydrogen and oxygen. In other words, in the real world, equations can be read both forward and backward. Similarly, if feeling passion and pride for my work helps me talk enthusiastically about what I do, so does talking excitedly about my work increase the passion and the pride I feel for it. This is why ancient Jewish wisdom insists that approval of our friends is an important aid to a person's business success. And likewise, people are stimulated and encouraged by their friends' approval. Even more important, this approval helps people find passion and enthusiasm in what they do. Conversely, if you are embarrassed about your business, you set yourself up to fail. Few sales professionals wholeheartedly and effectively promote products or services they feel to be shoddy or overpriced. Not only does your moral ambivalence inhibit all-out effort, but it also triggers a shame reflex. Instead of winning the approval of people whose opinions you value, you feel them radiating an almost palpable disapproval for your profession. You shrink into yourself and appear apologetic and embarrassed. This is hardly the posture of success. As a result, you will fail to talk about your work, thus forfeiting the ever-present advertising opportunities that present themselves in ordinary social interaction. Feeling virtuous about what you do is an enormous advantage, and one that has been a part of Jewish tradition since time immemorial. Developing a deep conviction of the intrinsic morality and dignity of business injects vast power into any enterprise undertaken. There is a very real and practical reason that companies engage me to teach their executives and employees that the process and practice of business, although as vulnerable to misdeed as any other, is inherently dignified and moral. People who view themselves as ethical and virtuous are far less likely to step over a legal line than are people who feel that they are already deeply involved in improper conduct. Have you ever cheated on a diet to which you were committed? I know that I have, and I recall how much easier it was to raid the refrigerator the second time. I remember how I had vacillated back and forth 3 hours earlier. How could I ruin the good efforts of the past week? I had asked myself. My yearnings for that chocolate cream pie were strongly countered by the realization that if I yielded to temptation, I would be turning the entire previous week of discipline into a farce. That held me off for a while. But then my stomach enzymes began howling in chorus for just a taste of that chocolate cream pie. As my fevered imagination recalled the delicious taste, I blocked out the disturbing but ever weaker calls of my conscience, and, I am sorry to confess, I yielded. The delicious taste, I discovered, was tempered by the slightly bitter taste of failure. However, 3 hours later, when I found myself again lusting for just one more slice of the same pie, the voice of conscience was far weaker. After all, this time I would not be destroying a perfect record of disciplined restraint. I had already done that 3 hours earlier. What is one more little slice? Nothing, really. One more little slice is never very much when you already consider yourself to have been slicing off more than you ought to have. The Jewish principle underpinning this observation is found in sayings of the fathers. Ben Azai said, "Hasten to commit good acts and flee from misdeed, since every good act encourages another in its wake, while every misdeed eases the way to the next." This is one reason for the enormous emphasis that Judaism places on atonement. The origin of the word atone was when one viewed oneself as being at one with God. The annual observance of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, allows Jews to reset the odometer of one's moral self-evaluation back to zero, as it were. God can once again regard us as having been at one with Him. Turning over a new leaf and making a fresh start is enormously liberating. It allows one to recover one's morally driven self-restraint that might otherwise have eroded beyond the point of usefulness. Similarly, in business, everyone encounters numerous opportunities to slice off a piece of pie that would best be left alone. Everyone finds frequent opportunities to cross the line in pursuit of just a little more. Some businessman who sees himself as already a swindling rogue just by virtue of his occupation, a greedy business professional profiting by seizing the earnings of gullible fools, should have little trouble seizing just a little more. No, you are not a swindling rogue. In reality, you are a noble person providing for others in a marvelous environment that benevolently rewards you for your consideration. You may find yourself smiling at these words, but once you have overcome your skepticism, you will have taken a giant step toward increasing your revenue. Money is holy, and holidays are linked to money. Indeed, overcoming one's skepticism about the nobility of money seems to be an intrinsic part of the original divine plan for Jews, as reflected in some of the Jewish holidays. One Jewish holiday in particular seems to focus on money. Almost everyone knows that Jews observe Hanukkah by lighting candles on each of the 8 nights of the holiday. Far less familiar are 2 details concerning the celebration. 1. Part of the observance is for the light from those candles to have no utilitarian purpose. For this reason, they are customarily lit in a room in which other lighting, perhaps the regular electric lighting, is blazing. This allows the candles to serve their exclusive symbolic function and perhaps stimulate a discussion among family members. Someone may well ask, why do we have candles lit if there is already plenty of light in the room? Another may inquire, can we turn off the lights so we can see the candles better? 2. There is a custom of giving children monetary gifts on Hanukkah. Like other people, Jews enjoy giving gifts of various kinds on all sorts of occasions. For instance, on Purim, the Feast of Esther, people give gifts of food delicacies to one another. However, Hanukkah is the only holiday on which not only is it not distasteful to give a gift of money, but it is viewed quite positively, especially for children. These 2 quirks of observance are linked by their explanation. The definitive code of Jewish law, compiled in 1563 by Rabbi Joseph Caro of Safed in the Holy Land, emphasizes that absolutely no benefit should be obtained from using the light of the Hanukkah candles. Then, conjuring up what we ought surely to condemn as an anti-Semitic stereotype, the code declares, "And even to examine your money, and to count how much money you have may not be done by the light of the Hanukkah candles." What? And I suppose that on all other occasions on which Jews light celebratory candles, such as those that usher in the Sabbath each Friday night, the first thing they choose to do is count their money? Hardly. The point is that on Hanukkah you are supposed to be super sensitive to your money and particularly grateful for it. This is so central a feature of the Hanukkah holiday that you might have been forgiven for supposing that counting your money in front of the holiday candles would be a way of enhancing the link between Hanukkah and your money. Thus, the code of Jewish law warns that you must not count your money by the light of the candles, even though you might have imagined that especially on this holiday, that is exactly what you should do. You should certainly count your money on Hanukkah, just not by the light of those special candles. They have a special symbolism that is linked to the money, but just a little loftier. What does light symbolize to people? Well, if you aren't sure, take a glance at your Sunday comics and see what a light bulb shown above the head of one of the characters means. It usually suggests that Dagwood has just had a bright idea. That is why folks sometimes say, "I have seen the light," when what they really mean is, "Oh yes, I understand perfectly," or someone might ask the person to whom he is patiently explaining something, "Do you see?" In reality, Hanukkah candles are intended for only one purpose, and that is to signify education and understanding. Even the name of the holiday, Hanukkah, is an expansion of the Hebrew word for education. This word comprises the first 4 out of the five letters making up the Hebrew word Hanukkah. Yes, education and money are very closely linked, but who doesn't know that? Quite a few people in the United States today, it turns out. Joining together the themes of the candles and the money, we find the reason for the custom of giving children money for each of the eight nights of Hanukkah in amounts that are proportional to the success of their studies. The money is a reward for the light they have gained during the past year. In this way, early in their development, children are inculcated with the idea that not only is money not bad, but it often can be a result of self-improvement. You receive money in proportion to how helpful you can make yourself to other people. Hanukkah is a reminder that educating oneself is surely one of the best ways of increasing one's potential to be helpful to others. Jews became bankers to help others, not as a last resort. In Western culture, the term moneylender has come to be an insult and an indictment. Obviously, people who view money lending, banking, or finance as sleazy and unworthy occupations are hardly likely to engage in them, let alone flourish in them. By contrast, Jews always viewed putting one's capital at risk to enable someone else to make a profit as an honorable way to earn a living and to help others. The Jewish hierarchy of charity regards lending someone money to go into business as more noble than simply giving him the money. The latter condemns the recipient to be a beggar without enough self-respect to launch his or her own enterprise. However, lending money to a needy man elevates him into an independent businessman. This way, his dignity is preserved, and he retains the psychological self-image so necessary to conducting business successfully. There is a popular historic misconception regarding how Jews in medieval Europe found themselves reluctantly thrust into banking. The theory argues that Jews turned to finance because of oppression and anti-Semitism on the part of the locals, who deny Jews access to the various artisan guilds and other more desirable professions, such as farming. Left without alternative, claims this incorrect theory, Jews reluctantly turn to banking. In reality, this is not why Jews became bankers. In many enlightened Islamic countries during the same period, although there were few restrictions on Jewish occupations, Jews also found themselves engaged in banking and finance. Jews did not flee toward finance, they selected it at the outset. Although Jews were not driven into banking by anti-Semitism, there is, nonetheless, an interesting link between Jewish bankers and anti-Semitism, as Winston Churchill described in England at the end of the 13th century. In those days, when the greatest princes were pitifully starved in cash, there was already in England one spring of credit bubbling feebly. The Jews had unseen and noiselessly lodged themselves in the social fabric of that fierce age. From time to time, they could be most helpful to personages in urgent need of money. This led the English Jews into a course of shocking imprudence. Land began to pass into the hand of Israel, either by direct sale or more often by mortgage. For some time past, there had been growing a wrathful reaction. Small landowners oppressed by mortgages, spendthrift nobles who had made bad bargains, were united in their complaints. King Edward saw himself able to conciliate powerful elements and escape from awkward debts by the simple and well-trodden path of anti-Semitism. The Jews were held up to universal hatred, were pillaged, maltreated, and finally expelled from the realm. Not until four centuries had elapsed was Oliver Cromwell, by furtive contacts with a moneyed Israelite, to open again the coasts of England to the enterprise of the Jewish race. debtors discovered an easy way to escape their obligations. It was simple. Get rid of the Jews. With the departing Jews went the inconvenient debts. It may not be a coincidence that in 1925, Adolf Hitler penned these words in his book Mein Kampf, in English, My Struggle. The best way to know the Jew is to study the road he takes. He comes as a merchant, and with his thousand-year-old mercantile dexterity, he quickly becomes active in finance and economics, which soon become his monopoly. Certainly, Jews in Weimar Germany between the two world wars did dominate the fields of banking and finance. This may have had something to do with their subsequent fate in that blood-stained land. However, the comfortable relationship Jews enjoyed with banking was far older than the Weimar Republic. The most famous Jewish banking house in Europe was that of the Rothschilds. Its reason for success is illustrated by the story of Prince William of Hesse-Kassel, who, in the very early 1800s, needed to remain invisible while lending a large sum of money to the Danish court. Using Mayor Amschel Rothschild as an intermediary allowed the prince to remain anonymous. Denmark paid the interest regularly to Rothschild, who reliably transferred it to the prince. A few years later, Napoleon announced that the House of Hesse-Kassel would no longer exist. This conveniently meant that all money owed to the prince was to be paid to the French treasury. The French did not know the identity of the prince's debtors, but they suspected correctly that Rothschild did. Although they offered Rothschild a 25% commission on debts he collected and handed over, the old man remained scrupulously loyal to his royal client. Rothschild and his two sons surreptitiously traveled throughout Germany, collecting all the debts due to His Serene Highness. It was not because of anti-Semitism that Rothschild became a wealthy banker. It was because he acquired a reputation of utter trustworthiness. You see that although, historically, anti-Semitism may have been a consequence of Jewish domination of finance, it was hardly the cause. If it wasn't anti-Semitic oppression that drove Jews into banking, what was it? The main reasons that Jews found their way into the fields of finance were undoubtedly trustworthiness and their conviction that they were fulfilling a necessary need in society. When a merchant in Venice gave a sum of money to a local Jewish banker, the merchant could rest assured that his supplier in Amsterdam would receive the equivalent funds from another Jewish banker in Holland. What was so vital was that the two Jewish bankers trusted one another. It was this intangible system of trust that made commerce and wealth creation possible. But there was another reason, too. Both Christians and Muslims accepted a rather literal interpretation of the Bible's prohibition against charging interest to borrowers. This absolutist view effectively eliminated banking as a profession for the faithful of those religions. A Jewish understanding of the Bible, on the other hand, depends on what Jews refer to as the oral Torah, whose ecclesiastical authority fully matches that of its written counterpart. Jews believe that God taught the oral Torah to Moses during the 40 days he spent on the summit of Sinai. It is from the oral Torah the Jews were able to learn under exactly which circumstances God permitted interest to be levied against the loan, and precisely how that loan contract needed to be drawn. As a result, Jews felt no compunction about earning their livings by brokering and providing capital loans. On the contrary, they felt that they were providing a vital and valued service. Obviously, the field of banking, like any other field, presents its moral challenges. Some financiers have become notorious for extorting usurious rates of interest. But Judaism explicitly prohibits that kind of exploitation of unfortunate people. Some have violated the rules, but this indicts them alone and not the occupation. The fabulous profits that banking has generated for its many Jewish practitioners over the centuries came chiefly from Jews feeling that the profession was honorable and helpful to society. They were not only willing to become bankers, they were also proud and eager to do so. Gold is good. God said so. Judaism literally bequeaths wealth to its adherents by communicating moral enthusiasm for the profession of business. One can find the roots of Jewish conviction in the morality of business right at the start of the Torah. Almost any child raised in a home that took Jewish scholarship seriously would have studied the first few chapters of the Bible before his or her 10th birthday, and the message of those chapters lies deep in the Jewish psyche. During the 7 days of creation, the word good is used 7 times, as God brings various parts of the world into being and expresses profound satisfaction at how they came out, as it were. Amazingly, the 8th appearance of the word good is applied to nothing other than the eternal symbol of money, gold. Right there, in the very beginning of the vast volume of the Torah, no more than 43 verses into the constitution of the Jewish people, gold, the ultimate medium of exchange, the metal of monetization, is described as good by God Himself. As you can imagine, that verse not only made Jews very comfortable in the jewelry business, another profession where Jews have excelled in many countries, but the verse also established within the collective Jewish subconscious the idea that gold, a metaphor for money and wealth, is good. Although Jews have certainly experienced more than their fair share of poverty through the centuries, often arriving on new shores as penniless refugees, wealth was always seen to be a blessing. In a well-loved monthly prayer regularly recited on the eve of each new moon, Jews feel quite comfortable asking God not only for health and peace, but also for prosperity. It is perfectly kosher to ask God for money. If you are comfortable with prayer, go ahead and include a request for prosperity in your prayers. What you are really asking for is the opportunity to serve your fellow human beings. The Talmud advises worshipers in the Jerusalem temple who wish to increase their wealth to pray facing the south, toward the direction of the table that held the ceremonial bread, because the bread was mystically linked to money. The mystical master and 13th century Kabbalist Nachmanides wrote of the ceremonial temple table and its showbread, "From the showbread upon the table came material blessings and economic abundance to all Israel." He described the bread as a sort of economic kickstart. Strangely enough, even today, the idea linking money and bread lingers with us as we colloquially refer to money as bread or dough. Deep within traditional Jewish culture lies the conviction that the only real way to achieve wealth is to attend diligently to the needs of others and to conduct oneself in an honorable and trustworthy fashion. Jews feel at ease blessing children each Sabbath with the words, "May God make you like Ephraim and like Manasseh." The oral Torah fills in the gaps by explaining that Ephraim represents spiritual steadfastness, and Manasseh represents economic creativity. The two belong together, and Jews wish their children to embody both. The Sabbath blessing to Jewish children continues with the biblical priestly blessing. May the Lord bless you and safeguard you. Again, the Oral Torah, quoted by the authoritative commentator Rashi, as well as by the 19th century leader of German Jewry, Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, explains the blessing to be for material wealth. The astounding news for the Jews was that God wants humans to be wealthy because wealth follows large-scale righteous conduct, which is His ultimate goal for His children. As Tevye the milkman puts it in the play Fiddler on the Roof, "I know it's no great shame to be poor, but it's no great honor either." In fact, the Bible emphasized the wealth of the patriarchs, and along with other requirements, being rich was necessary for being chosen as a prophet during biblical times. For instance, the Talmud records that not only did Moses himself possess enormous wealth, but so did most of the subsequent prophets of Israel. Rabbi Yochanan in the Talmud said, "God only allows His divine presence to rest on someone who is strong, wealthy, wise, and humble." The wise King Solomon said, "The crown of the wise is their wealth." And Jews have always understood that sentence to mean that God is happy with wise behavior and rewards it with wealth. Not only does the Bible commence with an account that includes God's warm and positive opinion of gold, but as you read further, you can see that the story about the origins of ancient Israel reaffirms the theme. Again, the Bible describes to its devotees the healthy outlook that legitimately acquiring money pleases God and is a positive experience. Ancient Israel as a nation had its beginnings in Egypt. Each Passover, Jews celebrate the Exodus from Egypt, highlighting the evening with the recitation of that escape. There is much emphasis on the haste in which they left the land of their subjugation. Hence, the unleavened matzahs that are eaten because there was no time for the bread to rise. Yet, in spite of their haste, it is clear that the ancient Israelites had ample time to take care of business. There may not have been time for bread to rise, but there was time for something far more important, obeying the Lord's instruction to Moses, "Let each Israelite request of the Egyptians silver and gold." Later, one reads, "The children of Israel carried out the word of Moses. They requested from the Egyptians silver, gold, and fabrics. The Egyptians granted their request, and they emptied Egypt." Formed in the crucible of hundreds of years of Egyptian slavery, ancient Israel finally experienced the Exodus, departing into the desert with sufficient gold and silver to later construct the tabernacle and to establish their own promised land. This theme, linking redemption and wealth, constantly reappears in Jewish culture. Money certainly isn't everything, but it mustn't be underrated either. In fact, it is a legitimate component of any divine redemption. It is no surprise that Jews have never been handicapped in business by feelings of moral confusion about money. I realize that the fact that Jews possess this extensive cultural reservoir affirming the morality of business is not necessarily of help to everyone. You might regard the Torah and its prescriptions as irrelevant to a modern business practitioner, certainly to a non-Jewish one. But my purpose has been merely to demonstrate how the Jewish people, throughout their often difficult history, derived real business effectiveness and economic power from possessing a deep conviction about business being an honorable profession. This is what allowed them, and indeed spurred them, to succeed. My task is to mark the path towards similar conviction for you. In my introduction, I said that you must be more than a mere reader. You need to be an active participant in your own redemption. You will need to walk your own path to conviction. The first marker on that path is to see most clearly how today's cultural forces defy your purpose. In that fashion, you will be able to design your own campaign to defeat those forces. Charity is good. Business is selfish. A popular misconception. As a business consultant, I spend considerable time in the offices of men and women who guide the destinies of great companies. On entering a client's office, I nearly always try to examine the plaques and testimonials on the wall. Among other citations, I have discovered awards from local Rotary clubs, photographs of hospitals to which my clients have donated funds, and thank yous for teaching classes to underprivileged youngsters. I make it a point to always identify at least one tribute that catches my eye. After studying it, I inquire about it in order to enjoy hearing the story behind the pictured benevolence. The business professionals are obviously proud of their philanthropic activity, and I believe suitably so. They can be cajoled into talking about their pet causes, and usually do so eloquently and passionately. But I have noticed that it is much easier to persuade business professionals to talk about the good they do outside the office than about the immeasurable good for society they do by running their businesses. For example, John Walton is a son of the late Sam Walton, the founder of the highly successful Walmart chain. John, himself high on the Forbes 400 list of wealthiest Americans, joined another tycoon, Theodore J. Forstman, founding partner of the investment banking concern Forstman Little, in setting up the Children's Scholarship Fund. This charity offers partial tuition scholarships for kindergarten through grade 12 to low-income families who want to send their children to a private school or educate them at home. The fund currently helps about 34,000 poor children in 47 states attend 7,000 private schools. Walton and Forstman are rightly proud of what they have achieved and are not only attempting to vastly increase the fund's capacity to provide yet more scholarships, but also actively encouraging others to do the same thing. Seattle business professional and Jewish philanthropist Stuart Sloan has created and built several large and successful commercial enterprises, including the much-praised QFC regional supermarket company, of which he is the former chairman. In what is thought to be the largest gift to a single U.S. public school, Sloan is giving $1 million a year for 8 years to the T.T. Minor Elementary School in Seattle's central area. Sloan wanted to transform the long-neglected school by focusing on the whole child for the whole year, creating a year-round school with a strong academic program and enough staff to tackle issues that get in the way of learning. Stuart Sloan is justifiably proud of what he is doing. Do Walton, Forstman, and Sloan, and thousands of less well-known Good Samaritans feel the same pride about the good they do in their day-to-day activities? Tens of thousands of people are able to take care of their families because they have a good job at Walmart. In addition, millions of U.S. families acquire their household needs at fair and advantageous prices. Under Ted Forstman's leadership, Gulfstream developed the new ultra-long-range business jet, the Gulfstream 5, which not only enabled people to travel faster and accomplish more, but also provided jobs and security to thousands of workers. I hope he feels as much pride in the success of the Gulfstream Aerospace Corporation as he does in the Children's Scholarship Fund he started. He ought to. Those accomplishments are praiseworthy. Is Sloan as proud of the good he has done helping people through his commercial activities as he is of his achievements at the T.T. Minor Elementary School? More to the point, Do the vast majority of Americans understand and appreciate what business contributes to their well-being? Do you feel the same pride in the good you accomplish merely by running your business as you do in the civic and charitable work you do? You can't earn an honest living without pleasing others. Here's another example. I knew a young woman who made a fairly good living for herself and her daughter as a pharmaceutical company representative. She visited doctors' offices and introduced the caregivers to her company's new medications. She often would relate to me the sheer terror she felt on walking into a doctor's office in her sales district. Then one day, while visiting her office, I overheard her on the phone. She sounded brutal. First she begged, and then she threatened. She obviously wasn't going to take no for an answer. After a few minutes, she hung up the phone with a triumphant grin. "Got him for $1,000," she crowed. It turned out that she was raising funds for breast cancer research. When I asked her why she felt so much more comfortable browbeating a contractor into a donation than a doctor into a pharmaceutical purchase, her shocking answer was, "But this is for a good cause." Few people can truly excel at occupations about which they entertain moral reservations. That woman was convinced that raising money for medical research was good and worthy, while selling pharmaceuticals was selfish. It made her uneasy. When asked about her occupation, she tried to disguise it as something other than what it was. However, she frequently related how much money she had raised for charity. Why would she never have considered boasting about the commission she earned the previous month? She was shocked when I suggested to her that her monthly commission check was a measure of how helpful she had been to the doctor, his patients, her own company, and the hundreds of other employees of her company who depended on her sales efforts. Deep down, she must have felt that selling medicine clearly did nothing for anyone else. She might even have suspected that she was helping her company earn the kind of obscene profits that television pundits constantly condemn. She had no confidence that her method of earning a living was more moral than that of a snake oil salesman of yesteryear. Deep down, she did not believe that she was doing the doctor and his patients a favor, while at the same time, of course, benefiting herself. Consider this final example. A rabbinic colleague recently consulted with me. He wanted to know whether I thought he could augment his income by joining a multi-level marketing company in which his neighbor had been trying to interest him. I asked him if he understood what it would really entail on a practical level. I saw him shift uneasily from foot to foot for a moment before answering. He would have to try to lure all his friends, relatives, and associates, making them consumers and distributors of his products, he explained. He saw himself as using his friends to further his own self-interest. It did not occur to him that he might just be the same answer to their dreams as his sponsor was to his own aspirations. It was clear to me that he would approach people as a supplicant, not as a benefactor. My answer to him was that although many succeed, some brilliantly, in multi-level marketing companies, he was unsuited to the enterprise. Those who do succeed are filled to the brim with passion, enthusiasm, and conviction. I reasoned that my rabbinic friend's demeanor and his very words indicated to me that he would feel uncomfortable involving his social circle in his business endeavors. I told him that it seemed to me as if he thought he would be exploiting them. He nodded his assent. Continuing, I explained that unless he was capable of believing that by involving his friends and relatives he was doing them the biggest favor imaginable, he should best seek an alternative avenue of enrichment. To really succeed in whatever is the business of your choice, you have to come to understand and utterly absorb into your being the fundamentally true idea that your activities in your business are virtuous and moral, provided, of course, that you conduct your business affairs honestly and honorably. Absorb this lesson into your heart and into your soul, and you will have overcome a major hurdle on your road to financial achievement. You must respect the dignity and the morality of business. This is one of the most important reasons why Jews have enjoyed economic success over the generations, and it is one that, regardless of your own background, you can use, too. You will just need to find your own way to seeing the beauty and the nobility in how you earn your living. It is far more than merely seeing yourself as an honest and good person. You must come to see that part of your goodness, part of the benefit you bring to others, is your daily conduct in operating your business enterprise. Whether you work in forestry, pharmaceuticals, or other industries that incur the wrath of the culture, whether you make widgets or run a small flower shop, you must understand the nobility inherent in going to work each day. The rule is that people seldom excel at any occupation that deep down they consider unworthy. And even if they are neutral about the morality of business, that neutrality is a weak reed on which to build success. How we are all persuaded that business is evil. If at this point you are wondering how anyone could feel that making money is immoral, let me assure you that everyone is subtly influenced by the culture surrounding us. More and more, that culture has been beaming out a high negative view of business and business people. Even the pro-business High and Lois cartoon presupposes that Lois's son has never been exposed through school, reading, or television to the shocking idea that business professionals like his dad can be heroic. Increasing numbers of Americans view wealth not as the morally legitimate rewards of risk, innovation, and effort, but as an unjust and morally suspect outcome. So pervasive is the message that almost nobody is completely immune to its insidious effects, and it comes from a broad cross-section of sources: education, the media, even business professionals themselves. How we are taught that business is bad from early education. It is sad that everyone seems to have been conditioned to moral skepticism regarding business. Imagine watching a high school teacher asking each of her students in turn to tell the class what career path they were interested in selecting and the reasons why. One boy stands up and announces, "I want to become an environmental consultant so I can ensure clean air and water for all." Everyone cheers. The next student informs the class that she wants to become a medical researcher in order to find a cure for AIDS. Everyone applauds wildly. Another student reveals that his dream is to become a teacher, so that I can help poor youngsters step on to the elevator of the American dream. Everyone gasps in admiration at the idealism of the future educator. Finally, the last girl is asked of her plans. She furrows her brows for a few moments and then slowly and clearly says, "I want to become a highly successful business executive, so I can improve the world and make a difference in many people's lives." I think that in most schools, guffaws of raucous laughter would greet this perfectly reasonable statement. This is not such an imaginary lesson. Between 1990 and 1995, Germany lost nearly 500,000 jobs. Although some of the economic battering experienced by the Germans during this period might be attributable to costs incurred in the reunification of East and West Germany, the German weekly magazine Wirtschaftswoche presented a different explanation. It claimed that the sad economic performance of the country whose industry gave the world the term economic miracle was due to Germany's educational establishment spending the previous three decades teaching kids that money is a bad thing. Wirtschaftswoche surveyed the country and revealed that 40% of Germans say they regard entrepreneurs as exploiters, up from 17% since the last poll in 1965. They discovered that a majority of 16 to 19-year-olds, presumably an age group ready for risks, says no thanks to the idea of starting a business. The older age groups who attended school prior to those years and escaped the educational anti-business indoctrination showed far more enthusiasm for entrepreneurial activity. When organizations, countries, or companies allow themselves to believe that making money lacks social value, they should not be surprised to see their economic performance decline. The same holds true for individuals. Movies and television conspire to make you poor. In his book, Hollywood vs. America, my longtime friend Michael Medved wrote that prior to 1965, television shows portrayed businessmen as good guys twice as often as bad guys. This ratio was reversed in the 1970s, when audiences were treated to two business villains for every good guy. Medved points out that during Hollywood's golden age in the 1930s and 1940s, businessmen frequently appeared in a highly sympathetic light. In the 1933 George Cukor classic Dinner at Eight, Lionel Barrymore played a decent and dignified shipping magnate, struggling to keep his company afloat. And in the cherished family film It's a Wonderful Life, Jimmy Stewart's character, George Bailey, is a humane, compassionate, and likable banker. Today, the very idea of a likable banker has become unthinkable. Big business has become the media's favorite villain. This evolution was noted by business columnist Daniel Seligman in his Forbes magazine article, Tom Cruise versus Corporate Evil. Seligman wrote that the movie Mission Impossible 2, the number one movie of summer 2000 in 25 countries, was also the new number one prototypical anti-business movie. Mission Impossible 2's villains set up an elaborate scheme to get rich off stock options, to be a little more precise, at which point Seligman wrote, "We know we are dealing with ultimate evil." An exhaustive analysis of primetime television by sociologists Robert Lichter, Linda Lichter, and Stanley Rothman concluded, "Clearly, the business of TV's businessmen is crime. In fact, this is the only occupational group on television that is disproportionately involved in crime. Even television children get the message that business professionals are evil." Lichter, and Rothman described an episode of Different Strokes in which two brothers go into business selling brownies. After accepting an order too large for their fledgling business to fulfill, they enlist the help of their sister.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.